Recorded Books and RB Digital present Gideon the Ninth by Tamsyn Muir, narrated by Moira Quirk. Dramatis Personae, in order of house appearance. The Ninth House, keepers of the locked tomb, house of the sewn tongue, the black vestals. Harrowhark Nonagesimus, heir to the House of the Ninth, Reverend Daughter of Dreaba. Palliamina Novenarius, her mother, Reverend Mother of Dreaba. Priam Hark Nonius Vianus, her father, Reverend Father of Dreaba. Autus Nigenad, Cavalier Primary to the heir. Crux, Marshal of the House of the Ninth. Iglamine, Captain of the Guard of the Ninth. Sister Lacrimorta, Nun of the Locked Tomb. Sister Isomorta, Nun of the Locked Tomb. Sister Glorica, Nun of the Locked Tomb. Some various followers, cultists, and laypeople of the Ninth, and Gideon Nav, indentured servant of the House of the Ninth. The First House. Necromancer Divine, King of the Nine Renewals, our Resurrector, the Necrolord Prime. The Emperor, his lictors, and the priesthood of Canaan House. The Second House. The Emperor's Strength, House of the Crimson Shield, the Centurion's House. Judith Deuterus, heir to the House of the Second, ranked captain of the cohort. Martyr Dias, Cavalier Primary to the heir, ranked first lieutenant of the cohort. The Third House, Mouth of the Emperor, the Procession, House of the Shining Dead. Coronabeth Tridentarius, heir to the House of the Third, Crown Prince of Ida. Ianthe Tridentarius, heir to the House of the Third, Princess of Ida. Naberius Turn, Cavalier Primary to the Heirs, Prince of Ida. The Fourth House, Hope of the Emperor, the Emperor's Sword. Isaac Tetarus, heir to the House of the Fourth, Baron of Tisus. Jean-Marie Chatur, Cavalier Primary to the Heir, Knight of Tisus. The Fifth House, Heart of the Emperor, Watchers over the River. Abigail Pent, heir to the House of the Fifth, Lady of Coniortus Court. Magnus Quinn, Cavalier Primary to the Heir, Seneschal of Coniortus Court. The Sixth House, the Emperor's Reason, the Master Wardens. Palamedes Sextus, heir to the House of the Sixth, Master Warden of the Library. Camilla Hecht, Cavalier Primary to the Heir, Warden's Hand of the Library. The Seventh House, Joy of the Emperor, the Rose Unblown. Dulcinea Septimus, heir to the House of the Seventh, Duchess of Rhodes. Protesilaus Ebdema, Cavalier Primary to the Heir, Knight of Rhodes. The Eighth House, Keepers of the Tome, the Forgiving House. Silas Octachizeron, heir to the House of the Eighth, Master Templar of the White Glass. Colum Asht, Cavalier Primary to the Heir, Templar of the White Glass. Two is for discipline, heedless of trial. Three for the gleam of a jewel or a smile. Four for fidelity facing ahead. Five for tradition and debts to the dead. Six for the truth over solace in lies. Seven for beauty that blossoms and dies. Eight for salvation no matter the cost. Nine for the tomb and for all that was lost. Act 1. Chapter 1. In the myriadic year of our Lord, the 10,000th year of the King Undying, the kindly Prince of Death, Gideon Nav packed her sword, her shoes, and her dirty magazines, and she escaped from the House of the Ninth. She didn't run. Gideon never ran unless she had to. In the absolute darkness before dawn, she brushed her teeth without concern and splashed her face with water, and even went so far as to sweep the dust off the floor of her cell. She shook out her big black church robe and hung it from the hook. Having done this every day for over a decade, she no longer needed light to do it by. This late in the equinox, No light would make it here for months in any case. You could tell the season by how hard the heating vents were creaking. She dressed herself from head to toe in polymer and synthetic weave. She combed her hair. Then Gideon whistled through her teeth as she unlocked her security cuff and arranged it and its stolen key considerately on her pillow, like a chocolate in a fancy hotel. Leaving her cell and swinging her pack over one shoulder, she took the time to walk down five flights to her mother's nameless catacomb niche. This was pure sentiment, as her mother hadn't been there since Gideon was little and would never go back in it now. Then came the long hike up 22 flights the back way, not one light relieving the greasy dark, heading to the split-off shaft in the pit where her ride would arrive. The shuttle was due in 2 hours. Out here you had an unimpeded view up to a pocket of ninth sky. It was soupy white where the atmosphere was pumped in thickest, and thin and navy where it wasn't. The bright bead of Domenicus winked benignly down from the mouth of the long vertical tunnel. In the dark, she made an opening amble of the field's perimeter, and she pressed her hands up hard against the cold and oily rock of the cave walls. Once this was done, she spent a long time methodically kicking apart every single innocuous drift and hummock of dirt and rock that had been left on the worn floor of the landing field. She dug the shabby steel toe of her boot into the hard-packed floor, but satisfied with the sheer improbability of anyone digging through it, left it alone. Not an inch of that huge, empty space did Gideon leave unchecked, and as the generator lights grumbled to half-hearted life, she checked it twice by sight. She climbed up the wire-meshed frames of the floodlights and checked them too, blinded by the glare, feeling blindly behind the metal housing, grimly comforted by what she didn't find. She parked herself on one of the destroyed humps of rubble in the dead centre. The lamps made lackluster any real light. They explosively birthed malformed shadow all around. The shades of the ninth were deep and shifty. They were bruise-coloured and cold. In these surrounds, Gideon rewarded herself with a little plastic bag of porridge. It tasted gorgeously grey and horrible. The morning started as every other morning had started in the ninth since the ninth began. She took a turn around the vast landing site, just for a change of pace, kicking absently at an untidy drift of grit as she went. She moved out to the balcony tier and looked down at the central cavern for signs of movement, worrying porridge from her molars with the tip of her tongue. After a while, there was the faraway upward clatter of the skeletons going to pick mindlessly at the snow leaks in the planter fields. Gideon saw them in her mind's eye, mucky ivory in the sulphurous dim, picks clattering over the ground, eyes a multitude of wavering red pinpricks. The first bell clanged its uncanorous, complaining call for beginning prayers, sounding, as always, like it was getting kicked down some stairs, a sort of blah-blang, blah-blang, blah-blang that had woken her up every morning that she could recall. Movement resulted. Gideon peered down at the bottom where shadows gathered over the cold white doors of Castle Dreaber, stately in the dirt, set into the rock 3 bodies wide and 6 bodies tall. 2 braziers stood on either side of the door and perpetually burned fatty, crappy smoke. Over the doors were tiny white figures in a multitude of poses, hundreds to thousands of them, carved using some weird trick where their eyes seemed to look right at you. Whenever Gideon had been made to go through those doors as a kid, she'd screamed like she was dying. More activity in the lowest tiers now. The light had settled into visibility. The ninth would be coming out of their cells after morning contemplation, getting ready to head for Arisen, and the Dreaber retainers would be preparing for the day ahead. They would perform many a solemn and inane ritual in the lower recesses. Gideon tossed her empty porridge bag over the side of the tier and sat down with her sword over her knees, cleaning it with a bit of rag. 40 minutes to go. Suddenly, the unchanging tedium of a ninth morning changed. The first bell sounded again. Blang, blablang, blablang. Gideon cocked her head to listen, finding her hands had stilled on her sword. It rang fully 20 times before stopping. Huh. Muster call. After a while came the clatter of the skeletons again, having obediently tossed down pick and hoe to meet their summons. They streamed down the tiers in an angular current, broken up every so often by some limping figure in vestments of rusting black. Gideon picked up her sword and cloth again. It was a cute try, but she wasn't buying. She didn't look up when heavy, stumping footsteps sounded on her tier, or for the rattle of rusting armour and the rusty rattle of breath. 30 whole minutes since I took it off, Crux, she said, hands busy. It's almost like you want me to leave here forever. Oh, shit, you absolutely do, though. You ordered a shuttle through deception, bubbled the Marshal of Dreaba, whose main claim to fame was that he was more decrepit alive than some of the legitimately dead. He stood before her on the landing field and gurgled with indignation. You falsified documents! You stole a key! You removed your cuff! You wrong this house! You misuse its goods! You steal its stock! Come on, Crux! We can come to some arrangement, Gideon coaxed, flipping her sword over and looking at it critically for nicks. You hate me, I hate you. Just let me go without a fight and you can retire in peace. Take up a hobby. Write your memoirs. You wrong this house. You misuse its goods. You steal its stock. Crux loved verbs. Say my shuttle exploded. I died and it was such a shame. Give me a break, Crux. I'm begging you here. I'll trade you a skin, Mag. Frontline titties of the fifth. This rendered the marshal momentarily too aghast to respond. Okay, I take it back. Frontline Titties isn't a real publication. Crux advanced like a glacier with an agenda. Gideon rolled backward off her seat as his antique fist came down, skidding out of his way with a shower of dust and gravel. Her sword she swiftly locked within its scabbard, and the scabbard she clutched in her arms like a child. She propelled herself backward, out of the way of his boot and his huge, hoary hands. Crux might have been very nearly dead, but he was built like gristle with what seemed like 30 knuckles to each fist. He was old, but he was goddamn ghastly. Easy, Marshal, she said, though she was the one floundering in the dirt. Take this much further and you're in danger of enjoying yourself. You talk so loudly for chattel, Nav, said the Marshal. You chatter so much for a debt. I hate you, and yet you are my wares and inventory. I have written up your lungs as lungs for the ninth. I have measured your gall as gall for the ninth. Your brain is a base and shriveled sponge, but it too is for the ninth. Come here, and I'll black your eyes for you and knock you dead. Gideon slid backward, keeping her distance. Crux, she said. A threat's meant to be, come here, or... Come here and I'll black your eyes for you and knock you dead, croaked the advancing old man. And then the lady has said that you will come to her. Only then did Gideon's palms prickle. She looked up at the scarecrow towering before her, and he stared back, one-eyed, horrible, baleful. The antiquated armour seemed to be rotting right off his body. Even though the livid, overstretched skin on his skull looked in danger of peeling right off, he gave the impression that he simply wouldn't care. Gideon suspected that, even though he had not a whit of necromancy in him, the day he died, Crux would keep going anyway out of sheer malice. Black my eyes and knock me dead, she said slowly, but your lady can go right to hell. Crux spat on her. That was disgusting, but whatever. His hand went to the long knife kept over one shoulder in a mould-splattered sheath, which he twitched to show a thin slice of blade. But at that, Gideon was on her feet with her scabbard held before her like a shield. One hand was on the grip, the other on the locket of the sheath. They both faced each other in impasse, her very still, the old man's breath loud and wet. Gideon said, "Don't make the mistake of drawing on me, Crux."
"You are not half as good with that sword as you think you are, Gideon Nav," said the Marshal of Dreaber. "And one day I'll flay you for disrespect. One day we will use your parts for paper. One day the sisters of the locked tomb will brush the os with your bristles. One day your obedient bones will dust all places you disdain and make the stones there shine with your fat. There is a muster, Nav, and I command you now to go."
Gideon lost her temper. "You go, you dead old dog, and you damn well tell her I'm already gone." To her enormous surprise, he wheeled around and stumped back to the dark and slippery tier. He rattled and cursed all the way, and she told herself that she had won before she even woke up that morning, that Crux was an impotent symbol of control, one last attempt to test if she was stupid enough or cowed enough to walk back behind the cold bars of her prison. The grey and putrid heart of Dreaber, the greyer and more putrid heart of its lady. She pulled her watch out of her pocket and checked it. 20 minutes to go, a quarter hour and change. Gideon was home free. Gideon was gone. Nothing and nobody could change that now.
"Crux is abusing you to anyone who will listen," said a voice from the entryway with 15 minutes to go. "He said you made your blade naked to him. He said you offered him sick pornographies."
Gideon's palms prickled again. She sat back down on her awkward throne of rocks and balanced her watch between her knees, staring at the tiny mechanical hand that counted the minutes.
"I'm not that dumb, Iglemine," she said. "Threaten a house official and I wouldn't make toilet wiper in the cohort." "And the pornography?"
"I did offer him stupendous work of a titty nature and he got offended," said Gideon. "It was a very perfect moment. The cohort's not going to care about that, though. Have I mentioned the cohort? You do know the cohort, right? The cohort I've left to enlist in 33 times? "Save the drama, you baby," said her swordmaster. "I know of your desires." Aglamine dragged herself into the small light of the landing field. The captain of the house guard had a head of melty scars and a missing leg, which an indifferently talented bone adept had replaced for her. It bowed horribly and gave her the appearance of a building with the foundations hastily shored up. She was younger than Crux, which was to say old as balls, but she had a quickness to her, a liveliness that was clean. The marshal was classic ninth and he was filthy rotten all the way through. 33 times, repeated Gideon, somewhat wearily. She checked back on her clockwork. 14 minutes to go. "The last time, she jammed me in the lift. The time before that, she turned off the heating and I got frostbite in 3 toes. Time before that, she poisoned my food and had me crapping blood for a month. Need I go on?" Her teacher was unmoved.
"There was no disservice done. You didn't get her permission."
"I'm allowed to apply for the military captain. I'm indentured, not a slave. I'm no fiscal use to her here."
"Beside the point. You chose a bad day to fly the coop."
Aglamine jerked her head downward.
"There's house business and you're wanted downstairs."
"This is her being sad and desperate," said Gideon. "This is her obsession. This is her need for control. There's nothing she can do. I'll keep my nose clean, keep my mouth shut. I'll even, you can write this down, you can quote me here, do my duty to the ninth house. But don't pretend at me, Iglemine, that the moment I go down there, a sack won't come down over my head and I won't spend the next 5 weeks concussed in an os. You egotistical fetus. You think Our Lady rang the muster call just for you? So, here's the thing. Your lady would set the locked tomb on fire if it meant I'd never see another sky, Gideon said, looking up. Your lady would stone-cold eat a baby if it meant she got to lock me up infinitely. Your lady would slather burning turds on the great aunts if she thought it would ruin my day. Your lady is the nastiest When Iglamine slapped her, it had none of the trembling affrontedness Crux might have slapped her with. She simply backhanded Gideon the way you might hit a barking animal. Gideon's head was starry with pain. You forget yourself, Gideon Nav, her teacher said shortly. You're no slave, but you'll serve the House of the Ninth until the day you die, and then thereafter, and you'll commit no sin of perfidy in my air. The bell was real. Will you come to muster of your own accord, or will you disgrace me? There was a time when she had done many things to avoid disgracing Iglemine. It was easy to be a disgrace in a vacuum, but she had a soft spot for the old soldier. Nobody had ever loved her in the House of the Ninth, and certainly Iglemine did not love her and would have laughed herself to her overdue death at the idea. But in her had been a measure of tolerance, a willingness to loosen the leash and see what Gideon could do with free rein. Gideon loved free rein. Iglamine had convinced the house to put a sword in Gideon's hands, not to waste her on serving altar or drudging in the os. Iglamine wasn't faithless. Gideon looked down and wiped her mouth with the back of her hand and saw the blood in her saliva and saw her sword, and she loved her sword so much she could frigging marry it. But she also saw her clock's minute hand ticking, ticking down. 12 minutes to go. You didn't cut loose by getting soft. For all its mouldering brittleness, the ninth was hard as iron. I guess I'll disgrace you, Gideon admitted easily. I feel like I was born to it. I'm naturally demeaning. Her swordmaster held her gaze with her aged hawk's face and her pouchy socket of an eye, and it was grim, but Gideon didn't look away. It would have made it somewhat easier if Iglamine had made a crux out of it and cursed her lavishly, but all she said was, such a quick study and you still don't understand. That's on my head, I suppose. The more you struggle against the ninth nav, the deeper it takes you. The louder you curse it, the louder they'll have you scream. Back straight as a poker, Iglamine walked away with her funny, seesawing walk, and Gideon felt as though she'd failed a test. It didn't matter, she told herself. Two down, none to go. 11 minutes until landing, her clockwork told her. 11 minutes and she was out. That was the only thing that mattered. That was the only thing that had mattered since a much younger Gideon had realised that. Unless she did something drastic, she was going to die here down in the dark. And, worst of all, that would only be the beginning. Nav was a Niner name, but Gideon didn't know where she'd been born. The remote, insensate planet where she lived was home to both the stronghold of the house and a tiny prison used only for those criminals whose crimes were too repugnant for their own houses to rehabilitate them on home turf. She'd never seen the place. The ninth house was an enormous hole cracked vertically into the planet's core, and the prison a bubble installation set halfway up into the atmosphere where the living conditions were probably a hell of a lot more clement. One day, 18 years ago, Gideon's mother had tumbled down the middle of the shaft in a drag chute and a battered hazard suit, like some moth drifting slowly down into the dark. The suit had been out of power for a couple of minutes. The woman landed brain dead. All the battery power had been sucked away by a biocontainer plugged into the suit, the kind you'd carry a transplant limb in, and inside that container was Gideon, only a day old. This was obviously mysterious as hell. Gideon had spent her life poring over the facts. The woman must have run out of juice an hour before landing. It was impossible that she would have cleared gravity from a drop above the planet, as her simple hairs would have exploded. The prison, which recorded every coming and going obsessively, denied her as an escapee. Some of the nun adepts of the locked tomb were sent for, those who knew the secrets for caging ghosts. Even they, old in their power then, seasoned necromancers of the dark and powerful House of the Ninth, couldn't rip the woman's shade back to explain herself. She would not be tempted back for fresh blood or old. She was too far gone by the time the exhausted nuns had tethered her by force, as though death had been a catalyst for the woman to hit the ground running and they only got one word out of her. She had screamed, "Gideon! Gideon! Gideon!" 3 times and fled. If the Ninth, enigmatic, uncanny Ninth, the House of the Sewn Tongue, the Anchorite's House, the House of Heretical Secrets, was nonplussed at having an infant on their hands, they moved fast anyway. The Ninth had historically filled its halls with penitents from other houses, mystics and pilgrims who found the call of this dreary order more attractive than their own birthrights. In the antiquated rules of those supplicants who moved between the 8 great households, she was taken as a very small bondswoman, not of the Ninth, but beholden to it. What greater debt could be accrued than that of being brought up? What position more honourable than vassal to Dreber? Let the baby grow up postulant. Push the child to be an oblate. They chipped her, surnamed her, and put her in the nursery. At that time, the tiny Ninth House boasted 200 children between infancy and 19 years of age, and Gideon was numbered 201st. Less than 2 years later, Gideon Nav would be one of only 3 children left, herself, a much older boy, and the infant heir of the Ninth House, daughter of its lord and lady. They knew by age 5 that she was not a necromancer, and suspected by 8 that she would never be a nun. Certainly they would have known by 10 that she knew too much, and that she could never be allowed to go. Gideon's appeals to better natures, financial rewards, moral obligations, outlined plans, and simple attempts to run away numbered 86 by the time she was 18. She'd started when she was 4. Chapter 2. There were 5 minutes to go when Gideon's 87th escape plan got messed up fantastically. "I see that your genius strategy, Griddle," said a final voice from the tearway, "was to order a shuttle and walk out the door." The lady of the Ninth House stood before the drill shaft, wearing black and sneering. Reverend Daughter, Harrowhark Nonagesimus, had pretty much cornered the market on wearing black and sneering. It comprised 100% of her personality. Gideon marvelled that someone could live in the universe only 17 years and yet wear black and sneer with such ancient self-assurance. Gideon said, "Hey, what can I say? I'm a tactician." The ornate, slightly soiled robes of the house dragged in the dust as the Reverend Daughter approached. She'd brought her marshal along, and Iglamine too. A few sisters were behind her on the tier, having sunk down to their knees. The cloister women painted their faces alabaster grey and drew black patterns on their cheeks and lips like death's heads. Dressed in breadths of rusty black cloth, they looked like a peanut gallery of sad old waist-high masks. "It's embarrassing that it had to come to this," said the Lady of the Ninth, pulling back her hood. Her pale, painted face was a white blotch among all the black, Even her hands were gloved. I don't care that you run away. I care that you do it badly. Take your hand from your sword. You're humiliating yourself. In under 10 minutes, a shuttle's going to come and take me to Trentham on the second, Gideon said, and did not take her hand from her sword. I'm going to get on it. I'm going to close the door. I'm going to wave goodbye. There is literally nothing you can do anymore to stop me. Harrow put one gloved hand before her and massaged her fingers thoughtfully. The light fell on her painted face and black-daubed chin and her short-cropped, dead-crow-coloured hair. All right, let's play this one through for interest's sake, she said. First objection, the cohort won't enlist an unreleased serf, you know. I faked your signature on the release form, said Gideon. But a single word from me and you're brought back in cuffs. You'll say nothing. Harrowhark ringed two fingers around one wrist and slowly worked the hand up and down. It's a cute story, but badly characterised, she said. Why the sudden mercy on my part? The moment you deny me leave to go, said Gideon, hand unmoving on her scabbard, the moment you call me back, the moment you give the cohort calls or, I don't know, some list of trumped-up criminal charges. Some of your magazines are very nasty, admitted the lady. That's the moment I squeal, said Gideon. I squeal so long and so loud they hear me from the eighth. I tell them everything. You know what I know, and I'll tell them the numbers. They'd bring me home in cuffs, but I'd come back laughing my ass off. At that, Harrowhark stopped working her scaphoid and glanced at Gideon. She gave a rather brusque hand wave to the geriatric fan club behind her, and they scattered, tottering, kissing the floor and rattling both their prayer beads and their unlubricated knee joints, disappearing into the darkness and down the tier. Only Crux and Iglamine stayed. Then Harrow cocked her head to the side, like a quizzical bird, and smiled a tiny, contemptuous smile. How coarse and ordinary, she said. How effective. How crass. My parents should have smothered you. I'd like to see them try it now, said Gideon, unmoved. You'd do it, even if there was no ultimate gain, the lady said, and she even seemed to be marvelling at it. Even though you know what you'd suffer, even though you know what it means. And all because... All because, said Gideon, checking her clock again. I completely fucking hate you. Because you are a hideous witch from hell. No offence. There was a pause. Oh, Griddle, said Harrow pityingly in the silence. But I don't even remember about you most of the time. They stared at each other. There was a lopsided smile tugging at Gideon's mouth, unsuppressed, and looking at it made Harrowhark's expression slide into something even moodier and more petulant. You have me at an impasse, she said, and she sounded grudgingly amazed by the fact. Your ride will be here in 5 minutes. I don't doubt you have all the documents and that they look good. It'd be master sin if I employed unwarranted violence. There is really nothing I can do. Gideon said nothing. Harrow said, The muster call is real, you know. There's important ninth business afoot. Won't you give a handful of minutes to take part in your house's last muster? Oh, hell no, said Gideon. Can I appeal to your deep sense of duty?
Nope, said Gideon.
Worth a try, admitted Harrow. She tapped her chin thoughtfully. What about a bribe?
This is going to be good, said Gideon to nobody in particular. Gideon, here's some money. You can spend it right here, on bones. Gideon, I'll always be nice and not a dick to you if you come back. You can have Crux's room. Gideon, here's a bed of writhing babes. It's the cloisterites, though, so they're 90% osteoporosis.
From out of her pocket, with no small amount of drama, Harrowhark drew a fresh piece of parchment. It was paper, real paper,
with the official letterhead of the House of the Ninth on the top. She must have raided the coffers for that one. The hairs on the back of Gideon's neck prickled in warning. Harrow ostentatiously walked forward to leave it at a safe middle point between them both and backed away with hands open in surrender.
Or, said the lady, as Gideon slowly went to pick it up, it could be an absolutely authentic purchase of your commission in the cohort. You can't forge this, Griddle. It's to be signed in blood, so don't stuff it down your trousers yet.
It was real Ninth Bond, written correctly and clearly. It purchased Gideon Nav's commission to second lieutenant, not privy to resale, but relinquishing capital if she honourably retired. It would grant her full officer training. The usual huge percentage of prizes and territory would be tithed to her house if they were won, but her inflated ninth serfdom would be paid for in 5 years on good conditions rather than 30. It was more than generous. Harrow was shooting herself in the foot. She was gamely firing into one foot and then taking aim at the other. She'd lose rights to Gideon forever. Gideon went absolutely cold.
You can't say I don't care, said Harrow.
You don't care, said Gideon. You'd have the nuns eat each other if you got bored. You are a psychopath.
Harrow said, if you don't want it, return it. I can still use the paper.
The only sensible option was to fold the bond into a dart and sail it back the way it came. 4 minutes until the shuttle landed and she was able to make hot tracks far away from this place. She'd already won, and this was a vulnerability that would put everything she'd worked for, months of puzzling out how to infiltrate the shuttle standing order system, months to hide her tracks, to get the right forms, to intercept communications, to wait and sweat, into jeopardy. It was a trick, and it was a Harrowhark Nonagesimus trick, which meant it was going to be atrociously nasty.
Gideon said, okay, name your price. I want you downstairs at the muster meeting.
She didn't bother to hide her amazement.
What are you announcing, Harrow?
The Reverend Daughter remained smileless.
Wouldn't you like to know?
There was a long moment. Gideon let a long breath escape through her teeth, and with a heroic effort, she dropped the paper on the ground and backed away.
Nah, she said,
and was interested to see a tiny beetling of the lady's black eyebrows.
I'll go my own way. I'm not going down into Dreber for you. Hell, I'm not going down into Dreber if you get my mother's skeleton to come do a jig for me.
Harrow bunched her gloved hands into fists and lost her composure.
For God's sake, Griddle, this is the perfect offer. I am giving you everything you've ever asked for, everything you've whined for so incessantly, without you even needing to have the grace or understanding to know why you couldn't have it. You threaten my house, you disrespect my retainers, you lie and cheat and sneak and steal. You know full well what you've done, and you know that you are a disgusting little cuckoo.
I hate it when you act like a butt-touched nun, said Gideon, who was only honestly sorry for one of the things in that lineup.
Fine, snarled Harrowhark,
now in every appearance of a fine temper. She was struggling out of her long, ornate robes, the human ribcage she wore clasped around her long torso shining whitely against the black. Crux cried out in dismay as she began to detach the little silver snaps that held it to her chest, but she silenced him with a curt gesture as she took it off. Gideon knew what she was doing. A great wave of commingled pity and disgust moved through her as she watched Harrow take off her bone bracelets, the teeth she kept at her neck, the little bone studs in her ears. All these she dumped in Crux's arms, stalking back to the shuttle field and presenting herself like an emptied quiver. Just in gloves and boots and shirt and trousers, with her cropped black head and her face pinched with wrath, She seemed like what she really was, a desperate girl younger than Gideon and rather small and feeble.
"Look, Nonagesimus," said Gideon, thoroughly unbalanced and now actually embarrassed. "Cut the bull. Don't do whatever you're about to do. Let me go."
"You don't get to turn and leave quite so easily, Nav," said Harrowhark with palpable chill.
"You want your ass kicked by way of goodbye?"
"Shut up," said the Lady of the Ninth,
and, horrifyingly,
"I'll alter the terms. A fair fight and..."
"And I leave scot-free? I'm not that stupid."
"No, a fair fight and you can go with the commission," said Harrow. "If I win, you come to the muster and you leave afterward, with the commission. If I lose, you leave now, with the commission."
She snatched the paper from the ground, pulled a fountain pen from her pocket, and slid it between her lips to stab it deeply into her cheek. It came out thick with blood, one of her party tricks, Gideon thought numbly, and signed, "Peliamina Novenarius, Reverend Mother of the Locked Tomb, Lady of Driober, Ruler of the Ninth House." Gideon said, feeling idiotic, "That's your mother's signature."
"I'm not going to sign as me, you utter moron. That would give the whole game away," said Harrow.
This close, Gideon could see the red starbursts at the corners of her eyes, the pink smears of someone who hadn't slept all night. She held out the commission, and Gideon snatched it with shameless hunger, folding it up and shoving it down her shirt and into her bandeau. Harrow didn't even smirk.
"Agree to duel me, Nav, in front of my marshal and guard. A fair fight."
Above all else, Harrowhark was a skeleton maker, and in her rage and pride, she was offering an unfair fight instead. The thoroughbred ninth adept had unmanned herself by starting a fight with nobody to raise and not even a bone button to help her. Gideon had seen Harrow in this mood only once before and had thought she would probably never see her in this mood again. Only a complete asshole would agree to such a duel, and Harrowhark knew it. It would take a dyed-in-the-wool douchebag. It would be an embarrassing act of cruelty.
"If I lose, I go to your meeting and leave with the commission," said Gideon.
"Yes.
If I win, I go with the commission now," said Gideon.
Blood flecked Harrow's lips.
"Yes."
Overhead, a roar of displaced air. A searchlight flickered over the drill shaft as the shuttle, finally making its descent, approached the wound in the planet's mantle. Gideon checked her clock. 2 minutes. Without a moment's hesitation, she patted the Reverend Daughter down, arms, midsection, legs, a quick clutch around the boots. Crux cried out again in disgust and dismay at the sight. Harrow said nothing, which was more contemptuous than anything she could have said. But you didn't get anywhere through softness. The house was hard as iron. You smashed iron where it was weak.
"You all heard her," she said to Crux, to Iglamine.
Crux stared back at her with the hate of an exploding star, the empty hate of pressure pulled inward, a deforming, light-devouring resentment. Iglamine refused to meet her gaze. That sucked, but fine. Gideon started digging around in her pack for her gloves.
"You heard her. You witnessed. I'm going either way, and she offered the terms. Fair fight. You swear by your mother it's a fair fight."
"Dare you, Nav!
By your mother and to the floor."
"I swear by my mother, I have nothing on me." "To the floor," snapped Harrow, breath coming in staccato pants of anger.
As Gideon hastily slipped on her polymer mitts, flipping the thick clasps shut at the wrists, her smile twisted.
"My God, Griddle, you're not even wearing leather. I'm hardly that good."
They stepped away from each other. Iglamine finally raised her voice over the growing noise of the shuttle.
"Gideon Nav, Take back your honor and give your lady a weapon.
Gideon couldn't help herself. Are you asking me to throw her a bone?
Nav! I gave her my whole life, said Gideon, and unsheathed her blade. The sword was really just a gesture. What ought to have happened was that Gideon raised a booted foot and knocked Harrow ass over tits, hard enough to prevent the Lady of the Ninth embarrassing herself by getting up over and over and over. A booted foot on Harrow's stomach and it would have all been done. She would have sat on Harrow if she'd needed to. No one in the Ninth House understood what cruelty was. Not really. None of them but the Reverend Daughter. None of them understood brutality. The knowledge had been dried out of them, evaporated by the dark that pooled at the bottom of Dreaber's endless catacombs. Idlaminae, or Crux, would have had to call it a fair fight won, and Gideon would have walked away a nearly free woman. What happened was that Harrowhark peeled off her gloves. Her hands were wrecked. The fingers were riddled with dirt and oozing cuts and grit stuck in the wounds and beneath the messed up nails. She dropped the gloves and wiggled her fingers in Gideon's direction, and Gideon had a split second to realise that it was drill shaft grit and that she was absolutely boned in all directions. She charged. It was too late. Next to the drifts of dirt and stone that she had carefully kicked apart, skeletons burst out of the hard earth where they had been hastily interred. Hands erupted from little pockets in the ground, perfect, four-fingered and thumbed. Gideon, stupid with assumption, kicked them off and careened sideways. She ran. It didn't matter. Every 5 feet, every five goddamned feet, bones burst from the ground, grasping her boots, her ankles, her trousers. She staggered away, desperate to find the limits of the field. There were none. The floor of the drill shaft was erupting in fingers and wrists, waving gently as though buffeted by the wind. Gideon looked at Harrow. Harrow was breaking out in blood sweat, and her returned stare was calm and cold and assured. She plunged back toward the Lady of Dreaber with an incoherent yell, smashing carpals and metacarpals to bits as she ran. But it didn't matter. From as little as a buried femur, a hidden tibia, skeletons formed for Harrow in perfect wholeness, and as Gideon neared their mistress, a tidal wave of reanimated bones crested down on her. Her booted foot knocked Harrow into the arms of two of her creations, who carted her easily out of harm's way. Harrowhark's unperturbed gaze disappeared behind a blur of fleshless men, of femur and tibia and supernaturally quick grasp. Gideon used her sword like a lever, showering herself in chips of bone and cartilage and trying to make each cut count. But there were too many of them. There were just so many. Replacements rose even as she pulverized them into rains of bone. More and more cannonballed her down to the ground, no matter in what direction she lurched, from the fruits of the morbid garden Harrow had sowed. The roar of the shuttle drowned out the clattering of bones and the blood in her ears as she was grabbed by dozens of hands. Harrowhark's talent had always been in scale, in making a fully realised construct from as little as an arm bone or a pelvis, able to make an army of them from what anyone else would need for one. And in some far-off way, Gideon had always known that this would be how she went, gang-banged to death by skeletons. The melee melted away to admit a booted foot that knocked her down. The bone men held her to the earth as she reared up, spitting and bleeding, to find Harrow, tucked between her grinning minions, pensive, serene. Harrowhark kicked Gideon in the face. For a couple of seconds, everything was red and black and white. Gideon's head lolled to the side as she coughed out a tooth, choking, thrashing to rise. The boot pressed itself to her throat,
then down and down and down, forcing her back into the hard grit floor. The shuttle's descent whipped up a storm of stinging dust, sending some of the skeletons flying. Harrow discarded them and they rattled into still anatomical piles.
"It's pathetic, Griddle," said the Lady of the Ninth.
Bones were shedding from her minions now after the initial adrenaline rush, peeling off and falling inert to earth, an arm there, a jawbone here, as they wobbled out of shape. She'd pushed herself very hard. Radiating out from them was a circle of burst pockets in the hard ground, like tiny exploded mines. She stood among her holes with a hot, bloody face and trickling nosebleed, and indifferently wiped her face with her forearm.
"It's pathetic," she repeated, slightly thick with blood. "I turn up the volume, I put on a show, you feel bad, you make it so easy. I got more hot and bothered digging all night."
"You dug,"
wheezed Gideon, rather muffled with grit and dust.
"All night?"
"Of course. This floor's hard as hell, and there's a lot to cover."
"You insane creep," said Gideon.
"Call it, Crux,"
ordered Harrowhark. It was with poorly hidden glee that her marshal called out,
"A fair fight. The foe is floored. A win for the Lady Nonagesimus."
The Lady Nonagesimus turned back to her two retainers and raised her arms up for her discarded robe to be slipped back around her shoulders. She coughed a small knot of blood up into the dirt and waved Crux off as he hovered about her. Gideon lifted her head, then let it fall back hard on the grit floor, dazed and cold. Iglamine was looking at her now, with an expression she couldn't pass. Sympathy? Disappointment? Guilt? The shuttle connected its docking feet to the ground, crunching hard into the floor. Gideon looked at it, its gleaming sides, its steaming engine vents, and tried to pull herself up on her elbows. She couldn't. She was too winded still. She couldn't even raise a shaking middle finger to the victor. She just kept looking at the shuttle and her suitcase and her sword.
"Buck up, Griddle," Harrowhark was saying. She spat another clot out on the ground, close to Gideon's head. "Captain, go and tell the pilot to sit and wait. He'll get paid for his time."
"What if he asks after his passenger, my lady?"
"God bless Iglamine."
"She's been delayed. Tell him he'll stand by on my grace for an hour with apologies. My parents have been waiting long enough, and this took somewhat longer than I thought it would. Marshal, get her down to the sanctuary."
Chapter 3 Gideon willed herself to pass out as Crux's cold, bony fingers closed around one of her ankles. It nearly worked. She woke up a few times to blink at the monotonous light that illuminated the lift down to the bottom of the main shaft, and stayed awake when the marshal dragged her like a sack of rotten goods across the bottom of the tier. She felt nothing. Not pain, not anger, not disappointment, just a curious sense of wonder and disconnect as she was hauled bodily through the doors of Dreaber. She stirred to life for one last escape attempt, but when he saw her scrabbling at the threadbare carpets on the slick dark floor, Crux kicked her in the head. Then she did pass out for a little while, for real, only waking up when she was heaped onto a forward pew. The pew was so cold her skin stuck to it, and each breath was like needles in the lung. She came to, freezing to the sound of the prayers. There was no spoken invocation in the ninth service. There was only the clatter of bones, knuckle bones, all threaded on woven cords, notched and worn, worked by nuns whose old fingers could pray on them so swiftly that the service became a murmurous rattle. It was a long, narrow hall, and she had been dumped right at the front of it. It was very dark. A rail of gas-discharged light ran all around the aisles, but it always lit like it didn't like the idea and glowed dismally. The arches overhead had been dusted with bioluminescent powders that sometimes trickled down as pale green glitter into the nave, and in all the radiating chapels sat speechless skeletons, still dusty from the farming. Squinting blearily over her shoulder, she saw that most of the sanctum was skeletons. It was a skeleton party. There was room in this deep, long channel of a church for 1,000, and it was half full of skeletons and only very pockmarked with people. The people mostly sat in the transept, veiled nuns and solitaires, shaven heads and cropped, the weary and scant inhabitants of the ninth house. Mostly priests of the locked tomb now. There hadn't been soldiers or military friars since she was very young. The only member left of that order was Iglamine, who'd left her leg and any hope of getting the hell out of here on some far-off front line. The clatter in the transept was occasionally interrupted by a wet, racking cough or the haggard clearing of somebody's throat. In the apse was a long bench, and there sat the last handful of the nobles of the House of the Ninth, Reverend Daughter Harrowhark sitting modestly to the side, face dusted with a handful of luminescent powder that had stuck to the blood trails coming out of her nose, her ghastly great-aunts and her parents, the Lord and Lady of the House, the Reverend Father and the Reverend Mother. The latter two had pride of place, before the altar, side on to the congregation. Crux had the honour of sitting on a chair in one of the dank chevets amid a sea of candles, half of them already out. Next to him sat the only house cavalier, Autus, a wide and sad ninth youngster of 35, and next to Autus sat his lady mother, an absolutely standard ninth crone who kept fussing at his ear with a handkerchief. Gideon blinked so that her vision would stop wobbling and focused on the apse. They hadn't managed to cousin her inside Dreaber for a good 2 years, and she hadn't seen the hideous great-aunts nor the lord and lady for a while. Blessed Sister Lacrimorta and Blessed Sister Isomorta were unaltered. They were still tiny, their faces still tight, grey-painted dribbles, and as the ninth was free from miracles, they were still blind. They had black bands tied over their faces with white staring eyes painted on the front. Each preferred to pray 2 sets of beads, 1 string in each shriveled hand, so they sat there clicking a 4-part percussion with their suspiciously agile fingers. Autus hadn't changed either. He was still lumpy and sad. Being the primary cavalier to the House of the Ninth had not for eras been a title of any renown. Cavaliers in other houses might be revered and noble men and women of long genealogy or particular talent, frequent heroes of Gideon's less prurient magazines. But in the ninth, everyone knew you were chosen for how many bones you could hump around. Autus was basically a morbid donkey. His father, cavalier to Harrow's father, had been an enormous, stony man of some gravity and devotion, with a sword and 2 huge panniers of fibulae. But Autus wasn't made in his mould. Coupling him to Harrow had been rather like yoking a donut to a cobra. Iglamine had probably focused her frustrations on Gideon because Autus was such a drip. He was a sensitive, awful young man, and his mother was obsessed with him. Each time he caught a cold, he was swaddled and made to lie still until he got bed sores. The Lord and Lady she looked at too, though she honestly didn't want to. Lady Pelliamina and Lord Priamhark sat side by side, one gloved hand placed on a knee, the other joined to their partners as they prayed simultaneously on a string of ornate bones. Black cloth swathed them toe to neck, and their faces were mostly obscured by dark hoods. Gideon could see their pale, waxy profiles, streaked with luminescent powder, the mark of Harrow's handprint still visible on both. Their eyes were closed. Pelliamina's face was still frozen and fine as it had been the last time Gideon had seen her, the dark wings of her brows unsilvered, the thin fretwork of lines next to each eye uncrowded by new. Priam's jaw was still firm, his shoulder unstooped, his brow clear and unlined. They were utterly unchanged, less changed even than the shitty great aunts. This was because they'd both been dead for years. Their mummified faces did not yield to time because, as Gideon knew, and the Marshal, and the Captain of the Guard, and nobody else in the universe, Harrowhark had frozen them forever. Ever the obsessive and secretive scholar, she had derived at great cost some forgotten way of preserving and puppeting the bodies. She had found a nasty, forbidden little book in the great ninth repositories of nasty, forbidden little books, and all the houses would have had a collective aneurysm if they knew she'd even read it. She hadn't executed it very well. Her parents were fine from the shoulders up, but from the shoulders down they were bad, though she had admittedly been 10. Gideon had been 11 when the Lord and Lady of the House of the Ninth had slipped into death in sudden awful secret. It was such a huge bag of ass how it had happened, what she'd found, what she'd seen. She hadn't been sad. If she'd been stuck being Hera's parents, she would have done the same years ago. "Listen," said the Reverend Daughter of the Ninth, rising to stand. The enthroned Lord and Lady should have taken charge of the sacred ritual, but they couldn't, because they were mega dead. Harrowhark had handily gotten around this by giving them a vow of silence. Every year she added to their penitence vows of fasting, of daily contemplation, of seclusion, so blandly and barefacedly that it seemed inevitable that someone would eventually say, "Hang on a minute, this sounds like a load of hot garbage," and she'd be found out. But she never was. Crux covered for her, and so did Iglamine, and the Lord's Cavalier had helpfully decided to die the day that Priam died, and so Gideon covered too, hating every moment, saving up this last secret in the hopes that with it she could extort her freedom. All prayer beads stopped clacking. The hands of Hera's parents stilled unnaturally in unison. Gideon slung her arms around the back of her pew and kicked one foot up atop the other, wishing her head would stop ringing.
"The noble house of the Ninth has called you here today," said Harrowhark, "because we have been given a gift of enormous import. Our sacred emperor, the Necrolord Prime, the king of the nine renewals, our resurrector, has sent us summons."
That got asses in seats.
The skeletons remained perfectly still and attentive, but a querulous excitement arose from the assorted ninth congregation. There were soft cries of joy. There were exclamations of praise and thankfulness. The letter could have been a drawing of a butt, and they would have been lining up thrice to kiss the edge of the paper.
"I will share this letter with you," said Harrowhark, "because nobody loves their people, their sacred brothers and sacred sisters, as the Ninth House loves her people, her devotees and her priests, her children and her faithful."
Gideon thought Hera was slathering it on pretty thick.
"If the Reverend Mother will permit her daughter to read?"
Like she'd say no with Hera's hands on her strings. With a pallid smile, Pelliamina gently inclined her head in a way she never had in life. Alive, she had been as chill and remote as ice at the bottom of a cave.
"With my gracious mother's permission," said Harrow, and began to read. "Addressing the House of the Ninth, its Reverend Lady Pelliamina Height Novenarius and its Reverend Lord Priam Height Nonius Vianus. Salutations to the House of the Ninth, and blessings upon its tombs, its peaceful dead, and its manifold mysteries.
His celestial kindliness, the first reborn, begs this house to honour its love for the Creator as set in the contract of tenderness made on the day of the resurrection, and humbly asks for the first fruits of your household.
My name is listed here, said Harrowhark, simpering modestly, then with less enthusiasm, and Ortis's.
For in need now are the Emperor's hands, the most blessed and beloved of the King Undying, the faithful and the everlasting. The Emperor calls now for postulants to the position of lictor, heirs to the 8 stalwarts who have served these 10,000 years, as many of them now lie waiting for the rivers to rise on the day they wake to their king. Those lonely guard, remaining petition for their numbers to be renewed and their lord above lords to find 8 new liegemen. To this end, we beg the first of your house and their cavalier to kneel in glory and attend the finest study, that of being the Emperor's bones and joints, his fists and gestures. 8 we hope will meditate and ascend to the Emperor in glory in the temple of the first house, 8 new lictors joined with their cavaliers, and if the Necrolord Highest blesses but does not take, they shall return home in full honour with trump and timbrel. There is no dutiful gift so perfect nor so lovely in his eyes.
Harrowhark lowered the paper to a long silence. A real silence, without even the hint of a prayer knuckle clacking or a skeleton's jaw falling off. The Ninth seemed completely taken aback. There was a wheezing squeal from one of the pews in the transept behind Gideon, as one of the faithful decided to go the whole hog and have a heart attack, and this distracted everyone. The nuns tried their best, but a few minutes later it was confirmed that one of the hermits had died of shock, and everyone around him celebrated his sacred good fortune. Gideon failed to hide a snicker as Harrowhark sighed, obviously calculating inside her head what this did to the current 9th census.
I won't!
A second hand disturbed the community tomb as Ortis's mother stood, finger trembling, her other arm draped around her son's shoulders. He looked completely affrighted. She looked as though she were about to follow the faithful departed to an untimely grave, face frozen beneath her alabaster base paint, black skull paint slipping with sweat.
My son! My son!
She cried out, shrill and cracked.
My firstborn sweet! His father's endowment! My only joy!
Sister Glorica, please, said Harrow, looking bored.
Ortis's mother had wrapped both arms around him now and was weeping fully into his shoulder. Her own shook with very real fear and grief. He looked wetly depressed. She was saying between sobs,
I gave you my husband, Lord Nonius Fianus. I gave you my spouse, Lord Nonius Fianus. Do you demand my son of me? Do you demand my son? Surely not! Surely not now!
You forget yourself, Glorica, Crux snapped.
I know the things that befall cavaliers, my lord. I know his fate.
Sister Glorica, Harrowhark said, be calm.
He is young,
quavered Ortis's mother, half pulling him into the safety of the chevet when she realised Lord Nonius Vianus would not intercede.
He is young. He is not robust.
Some would say otherwise, said Harrowhark, sotto voce. But Ortis said, with his big, sombre eyes and his squashed, disheartened voice,
I do fear death, my Lady Harrowhark.
A cavalier should welcome death, said Aiglamine, affronted.
Your father welcomed death unflinching, said Crux.
At this tender piece of sympathy, his mother burst into tears. The congregation muttered, mostly reproachful, and Gideon started to perk up. It wasn't quite the worst day of her life now. This was some A-grade entertainment. Autus, not bothering to disentangle himself from his sobbing parent, was mumbling that he would make sure she was provided for. The heinous great-aunts had returned to prayer and were crooning a wordless hymn. Crux was loudly abusing Autus's mother, and Harrowhark stood in this sea, mute and contemptuous as a monument.
"Leave and pray for guidance, or I'll have you. I'll take you off the sanctuary," Crux was saying.
"I gave this house everything. I paid the highest price."
"What comes of Mortis marrying an immigrant eighth, you shameful hag?"
Gideon was grinning so hugely that her split lips recommenced bleeding. Amid the massed heads of the uncaring dead and the disturbed devout, Harrowhark's eyes found hers, and that disdainful mask slipped in its blankness. Her lips thinned. The people clamoured. Gideon winked.
"Enough," snapped the Reverend Daughter, voice like a knife's edge. "Let us pray."
Silence sank over the congregation, like the slowly falling flakes of luminescent dust. The sobbing of Autus's mother hushed into silent, shuddering tears, buried in her son's chest as he put his doughy arm around her. He was crying soundlessly into her hair. The hymn of the nasty great-aunts ended on a high and tremulous note, never relieved, wasting away in mid-air. Harrow bowed her head, and her parents did too, simultaneous in obedience. The great-aunts nodded their heads to their chests. Aglamine and Crux followed suit. Gideon stared up at the ceiling and recrossed her ankles over each other, blinked bits of luminescent grit from her eyes.
"I pray the tomb is shut forever," recited Harrowhark with the curious fervidity she always showed in prayer. "I pray the rock is never rolled away. I pray that which was buried remains buried, insensate in perpetual rest with closed eye and stilled brain. I pray it lives. I pray it sleeps. I pray for the needs of the Emperor All-Giving, the Undying King, his virtues and his men. I pray for the second house, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, seventh, and eighth. I pray for the ninth house, and I pray for it to be fruitful. I pray for the soldiers and adepts far from home, and all those parts of the empire that live in unrest and disquiet. Let it be so."
They all prayed to let it be so, with much rattling of bones. Gideon had not prayed for a very long time. She looked over the bald, gleaming skulls of the assembled skeletons and the short-haired heads of the faithful ninth, and wondered what she'd do first when she left for Trentum. The sobs of Autus's unfortunate mother interrupted the clatter and her less-than-realistic thoughts of doing chin-ups in front of a dozen clapping ensigns, and she saw Hero whispering to Crux, gesturing at mother and son, her face a painting of bloodless patience. Crux led them off the sanctuary none too gently. They passed down the centre of the nave, Crux hustling, Autus lumbering, Autus's mother barely able to stand in her misery. Gideon gave the unfortunate cavalier a thumbs up as they passed. Autus returned a brief and watery smile. Muster broke up after that. Most of the congregation stayed to keep praying at their good fortune, knowing that the second Arius bell would be ringing in a scant hour anyway. Gideon would have vaulted up to leave and sprint back to her shuttle first thing, but the skeletons flooded out in neat, serried ranks down the centre of the nave, two abreast, blocking all other progress in their readiness to get back to their snow leaks and the heat lamps of their fields. The disgusting great-aunts removed themselves behind the parcloses to the claustrophobic family chapel off to one side, and Harrowhark ordered her parents' complacent mummies out of sight to wherever she usually hid them, back in their lavish household cell probably, and to bar the door after. Gideon was massaging sprains from her fingers as her swordmaster came seesawing down the aisle.
She lies, said Gideon absently, by way of greeting. If you hadn't noticed, she never keeps her promises, not a one.
Iglamine did not answer.
Gideon didn't expect her to.
She just stood there, not yet meeting her student's gaze, one liver-spotted hand clutched tight to the grip of her sword. Eventually she said gruffly,
You have always suffered from a want of duty, Nav. You can't argue that. You couldn't spell obligation if I shoved the letters up your ass.
I gotta say, I don't think that would help, said Gideon.
God, I'm glad you didn't teach me my spelling. A soldier's best quality is her sense of allegiance, of loyalty. Nothing else survives.
I know, said Gideon, and, experimenting, rose from the pew.
She was standing fine, but her ribs ached. One was probably cracked. Her butt hurt from being dragged. She was going to be swollen with bruises before nightfall, and she needed to have a tooth put back in. Not by one of the nuns, though. Never again. The cohort would have bone magicians aplenty.
I know, it's fine. Don't get me wrong, Captain. Where I'm going, I promise to piss fidelity all the livelong day. I have lots of fealty in me. I fealt the Emperor with every bone in my body. I fealt hard.
You wouldn't know fealty if it...
Don't hypothetically shove stuff up my butt again, said Gideon. It never does any good.
The lopsided old woman took a scabbard off her back and wearily handed it over. It was Gideon's. Her sword had been sheathed safely inside it. Aglamine tossed her the abandoned suitcase to boot. This would be the closest to an apology she would get. The woman would never touch her, and she would never give her a word that had no edges. But this was nearly tender for the captain of the guard, and Gideon would take it and run. Determined footsteps sounded down the centre aisle, alongside the sound of ancient lace rustling over slick obsidian. Gideon's gut tightened, but she said,
How the hell are you going to get out of this one, Nonagesimus?
I'm not, said Harrow, surprising her.
The Reverend Daughter's sharp-angled, foxy chin was thrust out, and she still had a thick rime of blood circling each nostril. But with her burning black eyes, she looked exalted as a bad bone saint.
I'm going. This is my chance for intercession. You couldn't comprehend.
I can't, but I also couldn't care less, said Gideon.
We all get our chances, Nav. You got yours.
Gideon wanted to punch her lights out, but she said instead with forced jollity,
By the way, I worked out your nasty little trick, jackass.
Iglamine did not cuff her for this, which was also some sort of apology. She just jabbed a warning finger in her direction. Harrow cocked her chin up in genuine surprise, hood falling away from her dark, short-cropped head.
Did you? She drawled. Really?
Your mother's signature on the commission. The sting in the tail. If I come clean, she said, that renders the signature null and void, doesn't it? It buys my silence. Well played. I'll have to keep my mouth shut when I hand that one over, and you know it.
Harrowhark cocked her head the other way, lightly.
I hadn't even thought of that, she said. I thought you meant the shuttle.
Alarm bells rang in Gideon's head, like the first and second peal all mixed together. She could feel the heat drain from her face, and she was already backing out of the pew into the aisle, wheeling away. Harrowhark's face was a painted study of innocence, of perfect unconcern. At the expression on Gideon's, Iglamine had put a hand on her sword, moving herself between the two with a warning stump of the leg. Gideon said with difficulty,
What about the shuttle?
Oh, Autus and his mother stole it, said Harrowhark. They must be gone already. She still has family back on the 8th and she thinks they'll take them in.
At her expression, Harrow laughed.
You make it so easy, Griddle. You always do.
Gideon had never confronted a broken heart before. She had never gotten far enough to have her heart broken. She knelt on the landing field, knees in the grit, arms clutched around herself. There was nothing left but blown out curly patterns in the pebbles where the shuttle had passed. A great dullness had sunk over her, a deep coldness, a thick stolidity. When her heart beat in her chest, it was with a huge, steady grief. Every pulse seemed to be the space between insensibility and knives. For some moments, she was awake, and she was filled with a slow-burning mine fire, the kind that never went out and crumbled everything from the inside. For all the other moments, it was as though she had gone somewhere else. Behind her stood the lady of the Ninth House, watching her with no satisfaction.
"I got wind of your plan only last week," she admitted.
Gideon said nothing.
"A week before," Harrow continued, "I wouldn't have known at all if I hadn't got the summons. You'd done everything right. They said I could put my reply on the shuttle I had previously scheduled if I wanted to write in paper. I will give you your due. There was no way you could have accounted for that. I could have spoiled it before, but I wanted to wait until now to do anything. I wanted to wait for the very moment when you thought you'd gotten away, to take it from you."
Gideon could only manage,
"Why?"
The girl's expression was the same as it was on the day that Gideon had found her parents dangling from the roof of their cell. It was blank and white and still.
"Because I completely fucking hate you," said Harrowhark. "No offense."
Chapter 4. It would have been neater, perhaps, if all of Gideon's disappointments and woes from birth downward had used that moment as a catalyst. If, filled with a new and fiery determination, she had equipped herself down there in the dark with fresh ambition to become free. She didn't. She got the depression. She lay in her cell, picking at life like it was a meal she didn't want to eat. She didn't touch her sword. She didn't go and jog around the planter fields and dream of what days looked like to cohort recruits. She stole a crate of the nutrient paste they put in the gruels and soups fed to the Ninth Faithful and squirted them in her mouth when she got hungry, listlessly leafing through magazines or lying back on her bed, crunching her body into sit-ups to make time go away. Crux had snapped the security cuff back on her ankle, and she rattled it when she moved, often not bothering to turn on the lights, clinking around in the dark. A week's grace was all she got. The Reverend Daughter turned up, as she always goddamn did, standing outside the locked door of her cell. Gideon knew she was there because the shadows in front of the little peephole changed, and because it would be nobody else. By way of hello, she said, "Fuck you," and switched to push-ups.
"Stop sulking, Griddle. Go choke on a dick. I have work for you," said Harrowhark.
Gideon let herself rest on the apex extension of her arms, staring down sightlessly at the cold floor, the sweat frosting on her back. Her ribs still hurt when she breathed, and the cuff was heavy on her ankle, and one of the nuns had jammed her tooth back in too hard, and it was like the woe of the Emperor every time she sneezed.
"Nonagesimus," she said slowly. "The only job I'd do for you would be if you wanted someone to hold the sword as you fell on it. The only job I'd do for you would be if you wanted your ass kicked so hard the locked tomb opened and a parade came out to sing, 'Lo, a destructed ass!' The only job I'd do would be if you wanted me to spot you while you backflipped off the top tier into Dreaber." "That's three jobs," said Harrowhark. "Die in a fire, Nonagesimus!"
There was a rustle from outside, the light scrape of a pin being pulled from a stud before it was pushed through the mesh of the peephole. Belatedly, Gideon scrambled up to toss it back, as one did a grenade.
but the bead of Harrow's earring had landed in her cell, and from that tiny mote of bone sprung humerus, radius, and ulna. A skeletal hand groped blindly at the key in the lock and turned it even as Gideon swung her boot around to smash it into splintery bits. It crumbled away to dust, including the stud. Harrowhark Nonagesimus swung open the door, haloed faintly in the electric lights from the tier, her acerbic little face as welcome as a knee to the groin.
"If you want to do something interesting, come with me," she commanded. "If you want to wallow in your shockingly vast reserves of self-pity, cut your throat and save me the food bill."
"Oh, damn, then can I join your old man and lady in the puppet show?"
"How the world would suffer without your wit," said Harrowhark blandly. "Get your robe. We're going down to the catacomb."
It was almost gratifying, Gideon reflected, struggling with the black folds of her church gown, that the heir to the House of the Ninth refused to walk with her on the inside of the tier. She walked close to the wall instead, keeping pace half a step behind Gideon, watching for Gideon's hands and Gideon's sword. Almost gratifying, but not quite. Harrow could make even overweening caution offensive. After long days with just her little reading lamp, Gideon's eyes stung from the lukewarm light of the ninth drill shaft. She blinked myopically as the lift rattled them down to the doors of Dreabur.
"We're not going into the inner sanctuary, you recreant," Harrow said as Gideon balked. "We're going to the monument. Come!"
The lifts that went down into the fetid bowels of Dreabur were death traps. The ones they entered now, down to the crypts, were especially bad. This one was an open platform of oxygen-addled creaking metal, tucked behind an iron door that Harrow opened with a tiny chip key from around her neck. As they descended, the air that rushed up to meet them was so cold that it made Gideon's eyes water. She pulled the hood of her cloak down over her head and shoved her hands up its sleeves. The central buried mechanism that made their pit on this planet possible sang its low, whining song, filling the elevator shaft, dying away as they went deeper and deeper into the rock. It was profoundly dark. Stark, strong lights swamped their landing, and they walked out into the labyrinth of cages filled with whirring generators that nobody knew how to work. The machines sat alone in their carved-out, chilly niches, garlanded with black crepe from ninth devotees long dead, their barred housings keeping the two at arm's length as they passed. The cave narrowed into a passageway, and the passageway terminated in a pitted door. Harrow pushed this open and led the way into a long, oblong chamber of bone-choked niches and bad copies of funerary masks, of wrapped bundles and seriously ancient grave goods. At one niche, Iglamine kneeled, having set herself the task of ransacking as many of the wrapped bundles as she could. Instead of a ninth robe, she wore a thick wool jacket and gloves, which gave her the appearance of a marshmallow pierced with four toothpicks of differing lengths. She was wearing a particularly po-faced, battle-weary expression as she picked through around 100 swords in varying stages of death. Next to her was a basket of daggers and a handful of knuckle knives. Some were rusted to hell. Some were halfway rusted to hell. She was examining a sword and gloomily rubbing at a bit of built-up plaque on the blade. "This plan is doomed," she said to them without looking up.
"Success, Captain," said Harrowhark.
"They're all archaeology, my lady."
"Unfortunate. What was Autus preferring these days?"
"Speaking freely," said Iglamine, "Autus preferred his mother and a book of sad poems. His father trained him to fight sword and buckler, but after his death..." She gave a somewhat creaking shrug. "He was a damned poor swordsman at his peak. He was not his father's son. I would have trained him sword and powder, but he said he had the catarrh."
"But his sword must be good, surely?"
"God no," said Iglamine. "It was heavy oil amalgam, and it had a rubber tip."
lighter than Nav's head. Harsh, said Gideon. No, lady. I'm looking for a blade in the style of his great-grandmother's, and a knife or a knuckle.
Powder, said Harrowhark decidedly, or chain.
A knife, I think, my lady, her captain said again, with more gentle deference than Gideon had known the old woman possessed. Knife or knuckle. The knife will be impossibly difficult to adjust to as it is. You fight in a crowd. A chain in close melee will be more of a danger to you than it will to anyone else.
Gideon had long since decided that this was not a good place to be, and that the plans being hatched here were not plans she liked. She started to edge backward toward the door, picking her path as lightly as possible.
Suddenly, there was Harrow, squeezing herself between two pillars and draping her arms above her head. Long folds of black robe shook down from her arms, making her look like a road-blocking bat.
Oh, Nav, no, she said calmly. Not when you owe me.
Owe you?
Why, of course, said Harrowhark. It was your shuttle my cavalier ran off in.
Gideon's fist jacked out toward Harrow's pointy nose. Less by design than accident, the other girl stumbled out of the way, half tripping, dusting herself off and narrowing her eyes as she circled around the pillar.
If you're going to start that again, she said, here.
She reached down and hauled up one of the discarded blades. It was at least mildly hilarious to see Harrow have to heave with all the might of her, like, three muscles. Gideon took it while the necromancer rubbed fretfully at her wrists.
Try that, she said.
Gideon unsheathed and examined the sword. Long black pieces of crooked metal formed a decaying basket hilt. A terrifically worn black pommel seal depicted the tomb wrapped in chains, the sign of the ninth. The blade itself was notched and cracked. Only way this kills someone is with lockjaw, she said. How are you going to get Autis back anyway?
Did Harrow look momentarily troubled?
We're not. I Glamine's too old for this.
And that is why you, Griddle, said the lady, are to act as Cavalier Primary of the House of the Ninth. You will accompany me to the first house as I study to become a lictor. You'll be my personal guard and companion, dutiful and loyal, and uphold the sacred name of this house and its people.
Once Gideon had stopped laughing, leaning against the icy pillar and beating on it with her fist, she had to breathe long and hard in order to not crack up again. The beleaguered grimace on Iglamine's hard-carved face had deepened into an outright sense of siege.
Whew! She managed, scrubbing away tears of mirth. Oh, damn! Give me a moment. Okay.
Like hell I will, Nonagesimus! Harrow ducked out from behind her pillar and she walked toward Gideon, hands still clasped together. Her face held the beatific, fire-white expression she'd had the day she told Gideon she was going off-planet, an unwavering resolve, almost like joy. She stopped in front of the other girl and looked up at her, shaking the hood from her dark head, and she closed her eyes into slits.
Come on, Nav, she said, and her voice was alight. This is your chance. This is your opportunity to come into glory. Follow me through this, and you can go anywhere. House Cavaliers can get any cohort position they like. Do this for me. And I won't just set you free. I'll set you free with a fortune, with a commission, with anything you want.
This nettled her. You don't own me.
Oh, Griddle, but I do, said Harrowhark. You're bound to the locked tomb, and at the end of the night, the locked tomb is me. The nominated hands are to enter the first house, Nav. Their names will be written in history as the new imperial saints. Nothing like this has ever happened before, and it may never happen again. Nav, I'm going to be a lictor.
Hello, I'm the woman who helped Harrowhark Nonagesimus' fascist rise to power, said Gideon to nobody in particular. Yes,
The universe sucks now. I knew this going in. Also, she betrayed me afterward, and now my body has been shot into the sun. Harrow came too close, and Gideon did what she had never done in the past. She raised the rusted sword so that its naked point was level with the other girl's forehead. The necromancer adept did not flinch, just made her black smeared mouth a mocking moo of shock. I will never trust you. Your promises mean nothing. You've got nothing to give me. I know what you'd do given half a chance. Harrow's dark eyes were on Gideon's, past the blade pointed at her skull. Oh, I have hurt your heart, she said. Gideon kept it absolutely level. I boo-hooed for hours.
It won't be the last time I make you weep.
Iglamine's voice rattled out. Put that damn thing down! I can't bear to see you hold it with that grip! And, shocking Gideon, consider this offer, Nav!
Gideon peered around Harrow's shoulder, letting the blade drop, trashing the miserable thing scabbardless in the nearest niche.
Captain, please don't be a proponent of this horseshit idea. It's the best idea we have, Nav, said her teacher. Our lady is going off planet. That's the long and short of it. You can stay here, in the house you hate, or go attain your liberty, in service to the house you hate. This is your one chance to leave, and to gain your freedom cleanly.
Harrowhark opened her mouth to say something, but surprising Gideon further, Iglamine silenced her with a gesture. The crappy swords were set aside with care, and the old woman pulled her bockety leg out from underneath her and leant the good one against the catacomb wall, pushing hard to stand with a clank of mail and bone disease.
You care nothing for the Ninth. That's fine. This is your chance to prove yourself. I'm not helping Nonagesimus become a lictor. She'll make me into boots. I have condemned your escapes, said Iglamine. They were graceless and feeble. But, she turned to the other girl, with all due respect, you've dealt her too ill, my lady. I hate this idea. If I were 10 years younger, I would beg you to condescend to take me. But you won't vouchsafe her, and so I must.
Must you? Said Harrow.
There was a curious softness in her voice. Her black gaze was searching for something in the captain of her guard, and she did not seem to be finding it.
I must, said Iglamine. You'll be leaving me and Crux in charge of the house. If I vouchsafe the freedom of Gideon Nav, and it is not given to her, then, begging pardon for my ingratitude, it is a betrayal of myself, who is your retainer, and was your mother's retainer.
Harrowhark said nothing. She wore a thin, pensive expression.
Gideon wasn't fooled.
This look usually betokened Harrow's brain percolating outrageous nastiness. But Gideon couldn't think straight. A horrible dark red heat was travelling up her neck, and she knew it would go right to her cheeks if she let it, so she pulled the hood up over her head and said not a word, and couldn't look at her swordmaster at all.
If she satisfies you, you must let her go, said Iglamine firmly.
Of course.
With all the gracious promises of the Ninth.
Oh, if she pulls this off, she can have whatever she likes, said Harrowhark easily, way too easily. She'll have glory squirting out each orifice. She can do or be anything she pleases, preferably over on the other side of the galaxy from where I am.
Then I thank you for your mercy and your grace, and regard the matter settled, said Iglamine. How is it settled? I have patently not agreed to this shit.
Both of them ignored Gideon.
Getting back to the original problem, said the old woman, settling painfully back down among the swords and the knives. Nav has had none of Ortis's training, not in manners, nor in general scholarship, and she was trained in the sword of heavy infantry.
Ignore the first. Her mental inadequacies can be compensated for. The second's what I'm interested in. How difficult is it for a normal swordswoman to switch from a double-handed blade to a cavalier rapier?
For a normal swordswoman to reach the standard of a house cavalier primary, you'd need years. For Nav, 3 months.
Here, Gideon died briefly of gratification. She revived only due to the rising horror consequent of everything else.
And she'd be up to the standard of the meanest, most behindhand cavalier alive.
Oh, nonsense, said Harrow languorously. She's a genius. With the proper motivation, Griddle could wield 2 swords in each hand and 1 in her mouth. While we were developing common sense, she studied the blade. Am I right, Griddle?
I haven't agreed to stone-cold dick, said Gideon, and I don't care how badass cavaliers are meant to be. I hate rapiers. All that bouncing around makes me feel tired. Now, a 2-hander, that's a swordsman's sword.
I don't disagree, said her teacher, but a house cavalier, with all her proper training, is a handsomely dangerous thing. I saw the primary cavalier of the House of the Second fight in his youth, and my God, I never forgot it.
Harrow was pacing in tiny circles now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.